Welcome, Iwantha.
Yeah, thanks. Hello, Hobart. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to DrupalSouth Day 2. I'll explain a little bit about myself. I am Iwantha Lekamge from Sri Lanka. I'm currently working as Associate Technical Lead at WSO2 Sri Lanka. I started my career about 8 years ago as a co-PHP engineer. Then I moved to a few PHP-related frameworks and platforms. And finally, I stopped at enjoying Drupal for 5 years. Currently, I am doing some implementations, Drupal implementations with new technologies. And today, I am going to present such an implementation. The name is Single Sign-On Across Drupal 8. So you all know that in today's digital-driven world, a connecting system is a must for an organization. It's very beneficial. When we consider about the organization, there are a lot of sites and systems. They are called HR systems, payroll systems, web system, blog, stock management, customer portal, a lot of systems. So let's say the user or employee of the organization want to access, want to log in all these systems. The user, what should do is, user want to register for each system separately, each site separately, and user want to log into them separately. We all know that it's not practical, so there should be a way to log into all systems using single set of user credentials. So that's what we are talking about single sign-on today. What is single sign-on? Single sign-on is an authentication mechanism. We can use it for single sign-on is an authentication mechanism that allows users to access multiple websites, web systems using single set of user credentials. So in here, user need to have only one username and a password, and user can log into all the sites and systems in the single sign-on environment. I'll take a few example and diagram, and I'll explain what is single sign-on and how single sign-on works. In a single sign-on environment, all the sites, systems of the organization are connected with the single authentication mechanism. So once user want to log into a system site, then user want to go via the single authentication mechanism and need to be get authenticated from there and need to access sites and systems. Let's say user want to access the HR system. So user need to click some link on their HR portal and need to get authenticated from that single authentication mechanism and need to access the HR system. The once user log into the single once user get authenticated from the single authentication mechanism, then user can access all the sites and systems in the single sign-on environment without logging to other sites and systems separately. The best known example is Google. You know that Google having different kind of sites and services like Gmail, YouTube, Google Drive, and Google Calendar, YouTube, just like that. So let's say some person want to access these Google services. Then once user logged into Gmail, the users can access all other Google services without logging to other sites, without logging to other services separately. In the same as once user register to one service, it will automatically register to other services, other some services, and user can access those services. So I will go through this example. This example, there are three sites has been connected with three sites are connected in some single sign-on environment to single authentication mechanism. Now user want to access these sites. So what user should do is user need to get authenticated from this single authentication mechanism and user need to access a site. So in here, user want to keep only one set of user credential for accessing all these sites and systems. So now people may think, right, it's like a little bit complex. Yes, actually it's a little bit complex. There are a few configurations. What are the benefits of having single sign-on environment and one set of user credentials? So the main benefit is user need to have only a single user credential to access multiple websites and multiple web systems in the single environment. As well as once user register to one system in this single sign-on environment, it will automatically register to all other sites and system in the same environment. In the meantime, the automatic login, as I explained it before, once user log into one system site in that environment, it will automatically log into all other sites and systems in the environment. The other benefit is single logout system. We are calling it as SLO. In there, once user logged out from one system, one site, it will automatically get logged out from all the sites and system on that environment. I think most of these benefits are from user side. So you maybe think, what are the benefits from organization side? Yeah, those are the benefits from organization sides. Why organizations need SSO? The main advantage is all the user details, user roles, user permissions are stored in centralized place. So it's easier to manage by the organization. So let's say user want to the organization want to stop accessing HR system for the all users in the organization. Then the server admin can log into the centralized system, the single authentication mechanism system, and the server admin can give the permissions to the relevant users to access HR system. And in the meantime, the operational cost and maintenance cost is very low. The reason is all the user details, user credentials, permissions are stored in a single place. So security-wise, the organization want to secure a single place instead of securing a lot of places like a lot of systems and sites. So in a migration-wise, it's easier to migrate. So as I explained, the users and user roles and user permissions are stored in a separate environment. And if you want to migrate one system to another, environment, so it's easier. The user details are separate, then migration process can be done. And also, sometimes organization want to add new site to this environment. Like say your organization want to add a stock management system for the single sign-on environment, then it's easier. Organization want to do the only single sign-on configuration because user has already configured, user details are configured. Then after single sign-on configuration, users can access the stock management system. So those are the benefits for the organization. So I'll little bit talk about these SSO standards, right? Actually, I got this from Google. There are few SSO standards, just like SAML 2.0, WS Federation, WS Trust, or 2.0, OpenID Connect, and SCIM. Today, I am going to talk about SAML. So what is SAML? SAML is XML-based data format, which is used for exchanging authentication and authorization information between identity provider and server provider. So this is the definition of SAML. So I will get a simple example, a diagram, and I will explain what is SAML, how SAML works, and what is identity provider, and what is service provider. So this is the definition of IDP, and service provider. So this is an example, right? There are three main entities involved in this environment: user and IDP and service provider. The IDP maintain the all user details, user roles, and authentication mechanism of the organization. Then service provider has host all services and all services of the organization. Now let's say user is there, user want to access the HR system, so user need to send a SAML request to IDP and need to get authenticated. The request is going to a service provider. Then after getting the request to IDP, its IDP is checking whether the request is coming from a known source, known service provider. Then if it is from a known service provider, then IDP execute the authentication request, and IDP sometimes connecting with the internal database or LDAP and getting authenticated the user and sending response as a SAML response and to service provider. Then service provider consume that response and create a session and given access to users for accessing the HR system. So this is the example and diagram. So I explained those steps. These are the steps involved in SAML environment. So the first system, the first one is user want to log into an application. So user is sending a request. Then service provider create a SAML request. Then and service provider send in that SAML request as a HTTP request to identity provider. Then identity provider check in whether it's coming from a known source, known service provider. If it is yes, getting the request and connecting to their LDAP or database or whatever and getting authenticated and create the SAML response and sending back to service provider. What service provider is doing, service provider consuming that response and creating the session and giving access to users. There are seven steps involved in here. So those are the steps. So now we are going to set up a single sign-on environment. So for that, these are the requirements we need. We need Simple SAML PHU library. This can be downloaded. And also, we need two Drupal instances and Simple SAML PHP auth Drupal module. This also can be downloaded. The last one, Simple SAML PHP underscore auth Drupal module, it's available for both Drupal 7 and Drupal 8. So for setting up a service provider and IDP provider, we need two Drupal instances. We are using SAML, and we are creating one Drupal instance as service provider and other Drupal instance as identity provider. So I have written a Medium article for this because we all know that I can't get a lot of time to go through the each step. So you can get basic idea what is single sign-on and how it works. And I have written this article. You can go through this article and you can set up your environment. So in the top part of the article, I will explain the theoretical part, basically the things I explained it before, right? In the latter part, I'll explain how to set up single sign-on environment. So now you can download Simple SAML PHP auth library from this path. And sometimes when you are going to install Simple SAML PHP auth library, there are prerequisite. You need to install the external auth. So you first of all, you need to install external auth, then Simple PHP auth library. In some cases, they are asking to Simple PHP auth library to run this command, because they are asking for some dependent libraries. If in such a requirement, run this command on your terminal. So now what I'm going to do is, now I have downloaded my Simple SAML PHP library and I am copy. I have already set up service provider. I have already set up Drupal environment. I am copy that downloaded Simple SAML PHP library to vendor folder of the Drupal service provider. I have created two Drupal instances, one for the service provider and one other one for identity provider. Now, what I am doing is, I am getting the downloaded Simple SAML PHP library and going to vendor folder and copy it to here. After that, we need to create a symlink. For that, you need to go to, first of all, you need to run this command. For that, you need to go to, and we need to run this command. Right, now I have created the symlink. After creating symlink, you can see Simple SAML folder in here. So we want to set up HT access for that. Please copy this written rules from my article and copy it down to HT access file on the Simple SAML directory. I have already copied it. Please be careful when copying from my article. Sometimes character problems can be happen. So please copy this to some notepad or something and get clean it and copy down to your HT access file. So after setting up the HT access file, now you want to configure the config.php file. For that, you need to go, I'll close down this, right. I'll go to Simple SAML PHP directory and go to config and config folder, and you need to configure all these configurations I mentioned in the article. First of all, we need to get the store type. We need to make it as store type as SQL, and we need to connect our Drupal database with this service provider. We are using host as localhost, Drupal then database as a Drupal local database. So I have written down this configuration details here. So after adding the database, you need to give permission to access the database. So you can set up username and password just like this. After that, you need to set up the admin password for the Simple SAML. The default password will be 123, but I have added ABC123. You can add whatever you want here. Then you need to give permission to access the IDP. For that, there is a configuration SAML 20 IDP. You need to make it as true. I have already make it as true. Then if you need, you can change technical contact name and technical name, but it's optional. I have put my email address here. If you need, you can change or you can keep default details. Then, now as I told you before, we created a symlink. So the Simple SAML environment is running on this symlink. So what we should do is, we need to configure the path for that. So we need to set the base profile, base URL. For latter part of the configuration file, please set up this configuration path. I have already set up the configuration path, my localhost environment, Drupal SP, and the symlink paths. So after setting up all these configurations, now we need to create the cert certification. For that, there is a folder inside the Simple SAML directory called cert. Right, in the cert, you need to run this command. So, as they ask in to create, they ask in a few details. I will set up like just like this. I'm from Colombo, and organization name let's put as DrupalSouth, and also DrupalSouth, and common name, host name, I have localhost, and my email address. So after creating that, you can see SAML, CRTM, SAML, PM files are created. Sorry. So after creating this environment, you can go to your local host. /simple SAML. Sorry, I need to restart my server. You can see the simple SAML installation page just like this, right? Configuration details are here, authentication details, and the federation details. Now we have already done with the service provider. Now we should, what we should do is we need to set up identity provider using simple SAML. So we need to set up, we need to run those steps like creating simple, creating symlink, and adding HT access file, adding access rules, and apart from that, you need to enable SAML 20 IDP as true for getting the request from service provider, and you need to set up store type as SQL. I will explain it. This is my identity provider. Go to vendor file. I have already created symlink and I updated the HT access file, and going to, you need to go to vendor and simple SAML and config folder, and you need to do the all configurations which we done before for this also. For the SAML 20 IDP, make it as true. And data store type SQL, database username, password, admin password, and the base URL. So after that, we need, after all these configurations, we need to enable authentication source. So there are different kind of authentication sources in there. So what I am doing is, there is a authentication resource called example auth and user pass. So I am enabling that authentication source. For that, you need to go to your IDP, cd Drupal IP, then go to vendor. So now we are going to enable the example loads. For that, you need to go to modules and example load, then you need to enable it. Vendor, simple SAML, modules, you can see you can see the all the modules, and example load, and you need to enable it. I have already enabled it. So after that, you need to go to auth resources php file of the same IDP, and we need to uncomment this example user pass array. So after uncommenting it, it has commented just like this. After uncommenting, it will be like this. So we are doing the authentication using array, but if you need, you can do using LDAP. LDAP configuration is also here, and if you need database, you can you can connect with the database and you can do the configuration. So after uncommenting this, the username is student, password is student pass, we are using UID as student, and email as student as example.com. Right after them, we need to create the certification again for the IDP, go to cert. And run this command here. Then after running this command, the SAML 20 IDP hosted file in the metadata will be with the server PEM file and server CRT file, because we have already run this and PEM and CRT file is created. So now IDP configuration is done. After end of the IDP configurations, Drupal IP / Simple SAML IP be like this. Now we have already set it up both identity provider and a service provider. Now I am going back to my article. So now, as I told you before, when IDP get a request from service provider, it's checking whether it's from the known source. So what you should do is you need to exchange a meta information between each other. You need to get, this is service provider metadata from here, and you need to go to IDP and metadata folder there is a file name SAML20SP remote. You need to copy that file to here, same as you need to get the IDP metadata. You can get it from here and you need to copy it, and you need to go to service provider and metadata, service provider and the metadata, and you need to copy it to here, idp remote.php file. So now we have already exchanged the metadata between IDP and service provider. Now what should we do is go to auth resources php file of the service provider, go to config and auth resources php file. I will close down others, I will write, and put the IDP metadata path in here, right. Basically you want to change only this part, and it change according to your configurations. And after all, you can go to service provider and go to authentication and test configurations. Then you can see that you created the application here, default SP. Click on that. We have set up username as student and password as student pass. Then it will get authenticated from identity provider and got the user ID as student and email as student@example.com. So now what we should do is, now we need to get Simple SAML PHP auth Drupal module, and you need to, as I asked, you need to configure it already, and you go to SP and user / logout. Log out from here and log in using your super admin details and go to configurations, and you can see the Simple SAML PHP auth settings. And we need to do a small configuration. The first one is you need to activate authentication via Simple SAML PHP. Click on it, and our authentication source, we created it as default SP, and the link, what should be the link people need to show for the click for login to IDP, and you need to save these details. And there is in the local authentication, which roles you should be allowed login to with local account. If you need, click on authenticated users. If so, user get created here as an authentication user. Otherwise, it's not mandatory. And if you want to remove super admin from this single sign-on environment, you can put your super admin ID here. If you have more IDs, you can use comma and you can mention those IDs here and update that. And go to user info and sync in. What should be the user identifier? As I told, we had two user identifiers in that array, UID equal student, UID equal employee. So we are using unique identifier as UID. And the username also we use as student, so we are using the parameter as UID. And email address we use student@example.com, so I'll use the parameter email as email address and save the configurations. End of everything, you have already set up SSO environment and you have already connected with Simple SAML PHP auth library. So now what you should do is you logged out and login. Once you login it, you can see the federated login icon here. Click on that. You will automatically redirect to Drupal.ip, this identity provider. Add your username and password. Login. You are redirected to service provider after the authentication. User has been created. This is user email address. So, in code level and the configuration level, there are a lot of steps to follow. I think it's not easy. If we missed one step, it will this environment is not created. So, as a result, we thought there are some open source SSO providers, right? I have listed a few in here. Those are the steps we went through, right? Those are the open source SSO providers: Aerobase, CS, Keylog, Shibboleth, WSO2 Identity Server. I am not sure whether all these open source projects are currently maintaining or not. But I know that this WSO2 Identity Server is maintaining. So I will explain how to configure the SSO in WSO Identity Server and Drupal 8, and how to create the single sign-on environment. For that, you need to download. WSO2 Identity Server. You can go WSO.com site, Identity Access Management, and you can download the binary file. And after downloading binary file, you need to. I have copied to my desktop, and I will open new terminal. I have written another article for that, how to configure WSO2 Identity Server SSO with Drupal 8. So it's also on Medium. You can go to medium.com/Iwantha and you can get all these articles. I have written the steps here. You have, first of all, you need to create a service provider using the Simple SAML in your local environment, in your Drupal environment. Then you need to download that WSO2 Identity Server binary file, and you need to copy somewhere. I have already copied in my desktop, and go to desktop and bin folder and run this command. I have mentioned it in my article, and starting it, it will be like this. I have already started, since it will take some time to start, just like 30 seconds to 40 seconds. So then after starting it, get this, and you can use username as admin. This is a console, and password as admin. I have stepped down all steps here, and you want to go each step in here, because I think we don't have much time to going through each step because I am running out of time, it seems. So after that, after connecting all these steps, basically you as we did before, you need to create your claim URLs, like we use claim URLs, claim user details as student before, and we need to create same details here. And the most important thing here is the identity server can be connected with LDAP or even local database or whatever, or you can create users in here and you can be connected. So I have created a user called Rangika, and now I have already set up this environment since I can't go through all the steps since we have no time. And I have locally set up Drupal environment for this, and I log out and I'm going to log in it. So now this Drupal environment is connected with WSO2 Identity Server. So I am click on federated login, then it will automatically redirect to identity environment. The port ID is 9443. Then I have created in user here, Rangika, and password I use, and you can log in. It will return it back to service provider, and user has been created here. Just like this. And also, I talk about single logout environment. Once you click on logout, it will call to this WSO2 identity server and get in back the response and clear the user session from the single sign-on environment. So those are the steps I mentioned in my Medium article. I did the demonstration, and these are the resources I have written to Medium articles. First one for how to create a single sign-on environment with Simple SAML, and second one is the WSO2 identity server, and GitHub environment for downloading Simple SAML PHP library, and Drupal org path for downloading Simple SAML or Drupal module, and the final one, the WSO2 identity server path for downloading the binary file for creating SSO environment. I think that's all, right? Are you good? Feeling good? Okay. Do you guys have any questions?
Thanks. So I had a question around config management.
Yeah.
So we see that we do a lot of changes in the Simple SAML library.
Yeah.
So how does it map with config management, or do we have to actually go into the actual Drupal environment on, let's say, production or test or development and make those changes, specifically the metadata that was copied across? So does it need to be done on each and every environment actually, or can it be pushed through config management files?
The first part of my presentation, I explained how to set up with the Simple SAML CHP. That's what I told. There are a lot of configuration. What you can do is, if you need, you can create a configuration file, because all the configurations are in different places, just like meta file and then configuration, config file, auth resources file. So for that, you can create a common configuration file, and you can update those configuration details here. And if you are using identity server console management, WSO2 identity server console management, I think the number of configurations are very low, since I can't go through all the steps. Sorry, I couldn't tell about you. But if you are going through my articles, I think the number of configurations are very low. So I think even in the local environment or development environment, test environment, production environment, I think it can be easily managed. If you are using Simple SAML basics, yeah, it's better to create some common configuration file and call to those pages separately. Okay, right.
I just noticed that you were creating like a user and identity provider server, right? Yeah. So what's happening with an existing like site when you have like a few thousand users, it's on this website, and basically there's going to be like syncing with all of these like sites together. So what would we do with syncing and creating all of these users on that identity provider?
Yeah. In SSO environment, as I explained, I'll go to. Yeah, the best example is this, right? So there are three websites, right? And user details are stored in the single sign-on environment in a centralized place, right? Let's say user come to first website and user creating a user account, but it's creating on that single sign-on, that single sign-on environment, right? And the second one also creating in there. Once user come, if user want to update the user details and user password, it will not create it in that website. It will update in the centralized environment, the single sign-on environment. So user details are not separately stored in separate places. So stored in a single environment. So there is no specific kind of sync between each other, right? So I think.
Do we still have to do that step to add the user to the SSO?
Sorry?
Do we still need to create that user?
Like yeah, I think when creating the users, yes, it should be created in single. Now I explain how to log into systems only, right? So in the registration, you need to store the details in some centralized database or LDAP, which can be accessed by identity provider, right? I think we did talk about how to register user. I think in the Drupal side, we can write a hook or something, and we can write this data to centralized LDAP or database, okay?
Hi, just got a question about the multiple protocol support for Simple SAML. So obviously it supports SAML, but it also supports OpenID Connect.
Sorry, I'm not clear you.
Okay, sorry. So it supports SAML, but also supports OpenID and OAuth2 for SPs, yes?
Sorry, actually I'm not clear with your question.
Okay, yeah, I'm just, so the IDP supports SAML,
yeah.
Yes? It supports OAuth2, it supports OpenID, yes?
You're asking about Simple SAML port?
Yes, yeah. Simple SAML does support that. What happens if you've got SPs, not all SPs support SAML these days? You know, we've got one that's, some things support CAS and not SAML. Some SPs support, you know, so can you mix and match is the question.
Yes, the answer for the question is yes. The port can be changed. And also if you need any caching mechanism, yes, it can be installed. Basically, there is no much restrictions. Let's say it's like you are running a local database and you are calling to that database and you are getting authenticated. It's just like similar to that. There is no much limitations on that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, no worries.
Thanks for your talk. I noticed when you logged in as student,
yeah,
you're still getting the default Drupal password fields presented, but presumably you don't want somebody trying to change their password on the SP. So does the Drupal module let you hide those fields from a non-administrator and send them to the IDP to manage their credentials there?
Okay. You are talking about this, I think.
I'm just thinking about the user experience. If you put that in front of an ordinary user, they're going to try and change their password there.
Are you talking about?
You
are talking about this, right?
Yeah, but when you logged into Drupal as student,
it
showed them the user page for that account.
Yeah.
But that's on the SP.
It's getting federated from there.
So if you only want federated, can you hide the others?
Actually, I am not. Yeah. Now log in.
So backtrack.
Well, it's, yeah, it's two different things.
Sorry?
Yeah.
If you log in.
Yeah.
Once you log in, you you can see user profile details and you can edit passwords there.
So yeah.
If you try to log in with the generated login.
Yes. Now let's say, right? Pass. Right now, you already logged in. So edit details. If you update these passwords, it will update the centralized database. Right now, in here, this is Drupal page. Right, if you update here, it will not update that place because we have not done that configuration. So we have to write a menu hook or some hook
or
something.
This is a syncing process.
Yeah, something.
About, like, there should be some
Yes. Actually, we don't want to keep these user passwords in a local our database, right? We can directly call to API or something, and we can store there in the centralized that identity provider site. So, according to this environment, now we have not configured for updating user details. We just work with only login part and logout part. So.
So out of the box, can you configure that to sync back, or do you have to build some code to hide these fields, or like how much is available in the module, and how much do you have to build?
For that, you need to do customization from Drupal side, and it's like you need to do a write a simple module, and you need to build some mechanism to. Using just like APIs to call the IDP, and you need to update those details in that side. In my opinion is we don't want to keep our user details in our service provider side, in our local side. So we need to create some mechanism here. Yes, we can do it because we have already done it. So once user update their user details, just like username, password, and their first name, last name, we can store there in the identity server, identity provider side instead of saving the local environment. Yeah.
And what if you want to hide the Drupal login?
Yeah. Yes, we should hide it.
How can we hide it? Is it do we need just to form alter, for example, and hide it? Is there like tick?
Yeah, I think in here. I'll explain. You need to in base.
So if you log in, if you want to hide username and password, then you
in
the
simply you can hide it from Drupal.
Yeah.
Yeah. In simply you can hide it from Drupal, or otherwise you can configure this. Now we have used federated login link in here, right? User need to click on that for going to IDP. So if you need. You can configure this username and password from this side. So you are typing your password and username and password in locally, and it will call to IDP. Now what we did is we click on federated login. So this is the clicking on federated login easier. So type this username and password here and call into IDPs, little bit complex, and we need to do few configurations for that. Yeah.
Last question.
Yes.
So what, like I remember we disabled students to log in from Drupal, right? Because it's only administrator was allowed to.
Yeah.
So what happens if we now just try to log in using students and the password?
It's not talking. No, it's not talking.
What's going to give us? Error?
Yeah, error, because the student details are not in our log. In this panel, in this login, username and password is connected with our internal local database. So we don't have user credentials in locally for the student. So its details are in the identity provider side. That's right. Okay. Any questions?
Yeah.
Okay. 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 Thank you. Thank you all.